We're devoting the entire program tonight to the opera Lucia de Lammermoor by Donizetti. And the opera was based on a novel by Sir Walter Scott, The Bride of Lammermoor. The first names, just to confuse things, the first names have been turned into Italian and the last names remain in English, which becomes very confusing. Anyway, at the end of the 1600s in Scotland, the Ashton and Ravenswood families have been at war with one another. And at the time that the curtain rises in the opera, the Ashton body count is well ahead, for there's only one Ravenswood left, and that's Edguardo. The Ashtons, however, have fallen into a bit of bother, for Enrico Ashton has lost all the family money, and his only hope of getting any money back is to persuade the sister, the lovely Lucia, to marry the local moneybags Arturo. Unfortunately for Enrico, Lucia is in love with Edguardo Ravenswood. And when Enrico hears about this from the captain of the guard, Normanno, he goes ape. And then he, Normanna, and the chaplain, Raimondo, sing a lovely trio, Crudo, Fornesto, Samina.
Crudo, Fornesto, Samina, tu mai svegliato in me, e troppo orribile, mi volgerai e fremere, solleva in fronte il crin, mi volgerai e fremere, solleva in fronte, solleva in fronte.
Thank you.
I want to dedicate each of the pieces of music on this program to various people, the memory of various people who have passed along, and I dedicate that last piece to the memory of Tom Noonan, who was the husband of Polly Connell in Broadford, County Limerick. Tom died recently. Anyway, back to Lucia de Lammermoor. The next scene sees Lucia going into the woods to await Edgardo, and she's accompanied by her friend Alyssa. Alyssa tells Lucia that the brother Enrico has got wind of the affair with Edgardo, and he's boiling. Lucia pays no attention, and instead she joins with Alyssa in singing a duet where Lucia tells a story about a ghost that she sees, a ghost of somebody who's been murdered and the body put in the fountain. It's quite daft, really. Anyway, it's one of the loveliest duets in opera, Regnana Nel Silenzio, and I played this in memory of somebody else, an old family friend who also died recently, Teddy Buckley.
Thank you.
Gordo then arrives in the scene, and he says to Lucia that he's got to go off to France on some important diplomatic business or other. And then he says that it's his intention to go to Lucia's brother, Enrico, and tell Enrico that he's in love with Lucia and wants to marry her, and that they should bury the hatchet. And Lucia is very alarmed at this prospect, because she knows that Enrico is hoping that she'll marry the moneybags fella. So she begs Edgardo not to do this. And Edgardo then loses the head and says that he swears an oath against all the Ashton family and all belong to them. And as they do in situations like that, Signoria Lucia tries to comfort him and calm him down, but not with great success. Anyway, they sing this fantastic aria, Sulla Tomba, and you're going to hear it in the voices of Joan Sutherland and Luciana Pavarotti. And I play this in memory of Josie Egan, Josie Savage, who in 1936 in Drumcolliher, County Limerick, started a mixed secondary school and gave education to hundreds of people in that part of West Limerick who otherwise, in North Cork, who otherwise would never have got a secondary education. So in memory of Josie Egan, here is Joan Sutherland and Luciana Pavarotti singing Sulla Tomba.
Sulla tomba, per il sangue, il tradito genitore, al tuo sangue, eterna guerra, io giurei nel mio furore.
Oh,
Dieu le
Oh,
Luciano Pavarotti and Joan Sutherland will be back. The next scene is several months later, and Eduardo hasn't returned from France, and Enrico is still trying to persuade the sister Lucia to marry the moneybags Arturo. And she's now beginning to think that perhaps she would, especially as she feels that if she doesn't do so, she'll let the family down, and she's sworn an oath or something to stand by the family. And Enrico finally persuades her to do this, and she's almost despairing, and she sings the beautiful lamentation along with Enrico, Sofria nel pianto, whereupon Enrico avers that she has been justly served for her treacherous love. And I play this for Brian Barry, son of my friends Oliver and Nolene Barry.
Yeah.
Scene is the wedding scene. Lucia is distraught, Enrico is desperate to get her married to Arturo. Arturo is confused, and then in comes Eduardo, and the four, along with Raimondo and Normano, sing the famous sextet "Chi mi freno," and I play this for Maura Tobin, who's mother of our colleague here in RTE, Ethna Hand. Maura died last year. She was a regular listener to this program.
Oh,
I think that's one of the loveliest pieces of music I've ever heard. My father used to play it on an old electrical gramophone. It was the first electrical gramophone we ever got, and he played it on a 45 record, and the other side of the record was the quartet from Rigoletto Bellafila dell'Amore. The version of it that my father had was with Gallicucci and Gili, and it was truly magnificent as well. But I think Sutherland and Pavarotti are just superb too. Anyway, let's go on with Lucia de Lammermoor. The next scene has Raimondo, who's the chaplain, arriving in suddenly. This is just after the wedding has taken place, I think, and he is in a terrible state altogether because he's just been up near the bridal suite, and guess what? No, wrong. Lucia has stabbed Arturo, the new husband, murdered him. And there's blood all over the place, and there's terrible commotion going on, and everyone is absolutely shocked. And the Gardaí have been called, but haven't arrived yet. And while they're hanging around waiting for the Gardaí to arrive, Raimondo sings A della stanza ove Lucia.
Amen.
played that for an old friend, Liam Hurricane, who died in 1992 or 1993. He was a correspondent in Belfast for RTE and also for a while in London, later joined the European Commission. He was press officer to Gareth Fitzgerald and Gareth's first government in 1981. He was an outstanding broadcaster, and it was a great loss. Died suddenly down in Carrick-on-Avon in either 1992 or 93. I think those melodies by Donizetti are just magnificent. He was hugely prolific. He wrote, I think, something in the region of 70 operas, and wrote many of them very quickly. He once was told that Rossini had taken 13 days to compose the Barbara Seville, and he said, oh, I absolutely believe it, Rossini has always been unbelievably lazy, which is really amazing how these people were able to write such magnificent operas and such magnificent arias in such a short time. I have no idea. I want to get to that famous mad scene from Lucia de Lammermoor, and Joan Sutherland, I think her performance in this mad scene is truly astonishing. Later, I hope we'll get to that famous tenor aria, Fra Poco, A Me Recovero. When we were down in Athlone recently for the special programme on John McCormack, we played a recording of John McCormack singing that aria, and that's magnificent. I think McCormack singing of that aria is magnificent, but tonight we have Pavarotti singing it. We now come to the famous mad scene from Lucia de Lammermoor, which is brilliantly performed here by Joan Sutherland. Lucia, having murdered her newly acquired husband in the bridal chamber, comes and joins the horrified guests. And she's obviously lost her mind, for she believes that she's with Edgardo and she has run away with him once more.
Oh,
Meanwhile, Edoardo thinks that Lucia has abandoned him and doesn't love him anymore. He's down among the tombs at Ravenswood, and he's preparing for his own death. And he sings this magnificent aria, Fra Poco Ame Ricovero, in which he imagines his neglected grave unwashed by any pitying tear, and warns Lucia that she should not, on any account, go that way on the arm of her new husband. She is at least to respect the ashes of the man who is about to die for her sake.
Nome, in cielo, nell'alma innamorata, e guarda mai innamorata, Well, let's look at the second set we do have, which is Donizetti, Lucia di Lammermoor, of course, from February 1959. And, well, this is all about one voice, isn't it?
Almost entirely, yes, it is. And it was, again, I was there on that first night. Talk about A Star Is Born. I mean, we all knew Jen Sutherland was a jolly good singer. Now, I'd heard her singing The Second Prioress in the Carmelites in the original production. She'd sung Desdemona, I think, and of course she created Jennifer in The Midsummer Marriage. So we all knew she was good. And, you know, the first appearance, the aria, Renyard and Elsinore, I mean, it's very beautiful and the sort of singing we knew she could do. But then the cavalletta that came up afterwards did make everyone sit up, because it was this extraordinary technical brilliance and a trill, apart from anything else, not something you hear a great deal of. And I think that was the moment when the audience really sat up and knew they were there on a historic night.
Sutherland in February 1959, live at the Royal Opera House, Covent Garden, singing Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor with Margareta Elkins as Aliza. Rodney Mills, you can hear all the words.
Yes, yes, in those days, Sutherland sang words. She then took about 30 years off, and then she came back to them at the end of her career. One mustn't be light-hearted about this. No, absolutely, all the words, absolutely clear. There's, at the end of this issue, there's a very charming little interview with her made the following year, in which, of course, the interviewer asks about her work with Giulio Serafin, the veteran conductor who had made his Covent Garden debut 50 years before. And Sutherland says that Maestro Serafin laid great stress on the words, and it jolly well shows, you know, it's quite apart from that technical brilliance. She's giving a performance of a dramatic role.
But this is Sutherland, what, just 9 days, when we're hearing this recording, 9 days after making her debut as Lucia. So it can't be as mature a performance as those later recordings when she'd lived with the role for that much longer.
Well, for me it is. I mean, this is my favourite of her accounts of Israel, I must say. I mean, mainly because of the words. The recording she made with Pritchard a few years later is fine. And the last time she did Lucia at Covent Garden with Carlo Bergonzi as Edgardo, I think their combined ages must have been about 130 or something like that. It was incredibly touching. But I don't think the clarity and the brilliance of this early performance really sort of surpassed them all.
What about the rest of the cast? Because it's not as balanced as the cast for Otello, is it?
Not really, no. The baritone is John Shaw. On the first night when I was there, it had been Geraint Evans, but Geraint found it very high and uncomfortable. So this was, in fact, John Shaw's first performance in the role. He was a great burly Australian, a wonderful Scarpia. That was his big role, and Rigoletto. And I do think it's slightly unkind of the booklet writer on this issue, saying that subtlety was not part of his armoury. Well, yes, I mean, the first aria and Cavalletto are good and loud, but I think when he sings the big duet with Lucia in the second act, it's lovely, it's absolutely fine, it's very tactful and a compliment to her. He knows that she's the boss. It's very fine singing.
Opera singers, Jen Sutherland as Lucia and John Shaw as Enrico in duet in the first act of Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor, the Covent Garden production from February 1959, conducted by Tullio Serafine, who spent a lot of time, as you were saying, Rodney, coaching Sutherland in this first performance of the role. But how well does he shape the rest of the opera?
I think very well indeed. I mean, for instance, in the mad scene, which we're obviously going to hear, the first part of that can come to a halt under a lesser conductor, and I just think the extreme tact with which he just keeps the rhythm going, the accompaniment going, while always being very sympathetic to Sutherland and the phrases she wants to make. That is sort of masterly conducting. Obviously, I mean, he was one of the key figures in Italian opera of the day for most of that century, and it wasn't just Sutherland that he made the great Lucia. I mean, there was, he did endless work with Callas beforehand, and went with virtually every singer in Italy at the time. And there is such wisdom in his conducting, such tact, really marvellous, I think. in its way as marvellous as Kubelik's or Vitello, but not as disciplined. I mean, it isn't always together, but I think if you're 80 plus, no, who cares?
But it is a much more vivid recording.
Oh, yes.
Does it capture some of the magic you remember from the performance?
Oh, yes, the sound is quite astonishing, I think. I just couldn't believe it. No, having listened to Otello first and the occasional degradation, this Lucia, it'll do.
So we have here the first two sets in the Royal Opera House's Heritage Series. As good a start as you could wish for?
Oh, I think so, because they were two groundbreaking nights, without a doubt. I think only the Don Carlos, when it comes, can measure up to this, just simply as history.
And the current music director, Antonio Papano, has said that he had concerns about sitting down to listen to these tapes when they were choosing them, but because of the difficulty of separating the live stage performance from the musical elements, as you put it. But he says he was blown away by both of these, and they obviously have something that you just can't get.
Yes, it takes one to know one. Maybe yeah. It takes a conductor to realise how very distinguished these performances are. And I think, as you say, we're going to hear the mad scene. But again, it's trills and words and this insane duel with the flute. I don't know who it's by, certainly not by Donizetti, but it was tradition. And this is a performance with traditional cuts, so we use the whole of the Wolf's Crag scene. There are little snips all over the place. So this is not a recording for purists. It's a recording certainly for people of my generation who remember the performances. You know, it's wonderful to hear them so clearly once more after all these years. And it's a recording for people who just want to hear, in this case, their sheer vocal brilliance.